England and the West Indies at Devonport Oval. Welcome to the highlights of the second last match in the preliminary section of the Benson Hedges World Series Cup. Australia not taking part today, but you can bet your life they will have been sitting watching to see which of the two teams will go through to the finals. If England don't win today, then they're gone. The reason for that is in the points table, as it stands at the moment, the Australians have 8 points and they have the best run rate. It looks to me that they are absolutely certain of going through to the finals. It would need a major miracle to stop them doing that. England have to win today to keep their hopes alive. West Indies, on the other hand, have two chances, but they have problems. Problems with the fitness of players. Thelston Payne has had to come in for Desmond Haynes, who injured a finger in the nets yesterday. Tony Gray has come in for the injured Michael Holding. He tore a hamstring in taking that Botham catch at the MCG at the weekend. The England team is the same as the one which went down to Australia over the weekend. Well, Tony Gregg reported that the pitch was fairly firm, but he thought there was enough moisture under the surface to give the bowlers plenty of hope, and that may well have been why Viv Richards, after he won the toss, put England into bat. We pick it up now in rather chilly conditions, temperature around about 19 degrees and a fierce wind blowing across the ground. No runs are on the board. Marshall is coming in to bowl to Broad, and your commentators are Ian Chappell and Bill Lurie.
That's a no ball, and it'll bring four to Chris Broad.
Chris Broad has been the foundation for England this summer in the batting lineup. It's very important for their point of view that he gets a start this morning. It scores at a reasonable rate. This is a fine shot, no ball, but beautifully played. Hit that right off the meat of the bat. That's a good, confident start.
Tony Gray has been brought into the West Indies side because of the injury to Michael Holding. And as always, when he's in the team, he opens the bowling. Excellent shot. Even into the wind, that one goes through to the boundary. Chris Broad, second of the morning.
Beautifully timed. Chris Broad strong of the square of the wicket, either on the on or off side. This time the square cut played beautifully. Third man trying hard into the wind, but to no avail.
Tony Gray is the bowler now, and he's coming into Ian Botham.
Beautifully hit. Hit downwind, and that's all you need to do from that end.
Ian Botham hasn't had a good series with the bat, but that was a sign of a man coming into form. It was beautifully played. This is the thing that Botham can do with that tremendous power. It went like a rocket to the fence through the cover region. On the up, standing to attention, and bang.
And gone. Well taken by Richie Richardson. He had to take a couple of paces back pretty quickly. And so that's a good answer there from the fast bowler, Tony Gray.
Well, Ian Botham has a problem with the extra bounce on Australian wickets. It's not that he's looking at the wicket, but that's not the first time that Botham has been caught in a gully or point region. When he doesn't cover the extra bounce, he stands at attention and pushes the bat out. It's sort of loose-handed effort, well caught by Richardson, and Gray strikes back. The first wicket's down, that of Botham. A valuable wicket for the West Indian side. He's out for eight. That's one for 23.
David Gower batting at number three. He's done that right through the World Series Cup competition. And he's in to join the other left-hander, Chris Broad. Right-hander is gone.
He's playing in front of his body, a little bit of extra bounce there. Good catch, well judged. It flew. Good support for the bowler, Gray. Dangerous. Botham's removed once again. Not keeping the ball down, playing well in front of his body. Caught by Richardson at a deep gully position.
Sure whether Tony Gray's trying to keep loose or keep warm. Pretty cool here at the Devonport Oval. Oh, and almost a second catch there for Richie Richardson in the gully. That would have been a beauty.
Well, David Gower does give you a bit of a chance there. First ball, he hit it right off the meat of the bat, but doesn't keep it down. It went straight to Richie Richardson like a board. He got both hands to it, and it jumped out. Right off the meat of the bat, says David Gower. Looks at the centre of his bat there. It went like a tracer bullet. There it goes. Richardson got his hands to it, diving to the right, and put it down. Marshall, fine exponent of fast bowling, well balanced. He runs through the crease. He's not a rocker. He goes straight through, flat out.
Well, he's shouted for it, claimed it, and Gower, after some hesitation, is gone. New man comes into the West Indies side and takes the vital catch, Thelston Payne, who's scheduled to open in place of Desmond Haynes.
Normally a bit of a wicket keeper, but what a great catch. A long way forward. That one held up into the breeze just long enough for him to get the hand cupped underneath it. So Gower, an indifferent innings of three there for 18 deliveries. England have lost two now with a score at 29. And Lamb's at the crease because of the dismissal of David Gower. He timed that fairly sweetly. But just a carry. What a magnificent catch. And again, we see the tremendous range of fielding ability of the West Indies. The men inside that 30-metre circle, Roger Harper, Gus Logie, Viv Richards, and now Thelston Payne.
Joel Garner is the bowler.
Lovely shot. That's the way Broad has been picking up most of his runs so far. Anything short outside the off stump, he's pounced on it. He's played that shot really well. And that's his third boundary with that square cut.
Yes, he got off the mark with a shot from this end as well. Have a look how he gets up and over the top of the ball there and simply brings that bottom hand into play. Garner, not an easy customer on this pitch, but that was a lovely shot. Played just behind square, right off the meat of the bat.
Walsh in his fourth over. Oh, just wide, outside edge and down to third man for four.
Yes, that ball went very quickly. He made a desperate effort to do Jean. Have a look at this. Very wide and down he went in a flash, but that one went away in a hurry and it was quite wide too. So four to Lamb. That's an area where a lot of the good players score runs in these one-day games. There's always a bit of a gap there because there are no slips. And that one running away quickly down to the boundary at third man.
Roger Harper continues from the northern or straight end.
Thank you, Ian. Harper continues, and that's a big hit. Courtney Walsh coming down. It's with the wind. It's over the ropes. And that's six. Well, that's a break for Alan Lamb. He's been struggling to hit the ball in the middle. He chose to hit with the wind, hit straight down the ground. It was a high, lofted shot. Down the wicket he comes, smashes it over long on. Courtney Walsh is there, trying to judge it. It goes over the ropes, 4-6. So last some relief for Alan Lamb in England.
It's hit away. This could be out. He's going to be caught, I'd say. Very well taken. Way down there at deep square leg. The catch made there by little Gus Logie, I'd say. Moving in from deep mid-wicket.
Oh, man, surprisingly hitting into the breeze. He's hit one glorious six straight down the ground. He's probably beaten in flight. He pushed it to leg stump and forced him to hit square. And Gus Logie took a brilliant catch. It was well judged. It was dropping into that strong breeze. And that was a vital wicket for the West Indies. A brilliant piece of fielding by the golden Logie. Lamb out for 36, 3 for 103.
Mike Gatting out there for England. He's joined Chris Broad.
Well, the West Indies bowling has been well supported in the field today. Excellent catching by Richie Richardson, and this time Gasologi dropping with the breeze, a very strong breeze coming square on. That ball hit straight into that breeze through mid-wicket. Great catch.
Tony Gray, the bowler. Oh, and that one very close to Logie. Wouldn't that have been a sensational catch? Just alongside the umpire, he went diving away to his right. He wasn't quite able to get a hand on that one.
Chris Broad hit that pretty well too. He was back, nice position. He rolled the wrist and just lifted it just wide of Gasologi. It was just a fraction late and it raced away for four. So as Broad moves on to 49, I wouldn't say there was any luck there. He placed it well enough, but normally a chance. The great Logie moving quickly to his right. Now he's pushed back by Vivian Richards. Cut off the possibility of another boundary.
Yes, that was a good, very good effort by Logie. And that's his 50. Nicely played away over the infield, the ball running down to the extra cover boundary. So Broad's 50 in 110 balls, and he really has been England's best player here today.
So here's Gray. In the air, and a catch for Richardson. He takes it comfortably. So Mike Gatting goes, another wicket for Tony Gray, another wicket for the Richardson-Gray combination.
That's a blow for England, and certainly for Gatting. Looked to me as though he changed his mind. He was shuffling his feet there, trying to put the bowler off. In the end, he was the only one put off. Hitting it with the wind, but he must have got it away from the centre of the bat. Not far short of the wind carrying it for six, but just short enough. And it's 4 for 129. Bill Athey is averaging 33 in these matches. He's had a little bit of a problem. He's been moved down, was opening, and now he's coming in the middle of the order. Both of them has taken his place at the top. Athey has the task now of pushing the scoring along after that dismissal of the England skipper, Mike Gatting.
Yes, he was moving around before the bowler came in. And there is Richie Richardson taking the catch, as we used to be told when we were at school, in the Australian fashion, with the fingers pointing upwards, taking it in front of his face. So Malcolm Marshall comes back. He has four overs left. He's gone. Came inside of his wicket, trying to turn on the onside. Very confident appeal, and umpire Randall sent him on his way.
Absolutely plumb. Just trying to push the ball away on the onside. Now England getting themselves into trouble. They have to win this match, and there'll be just a little touch of panic. 5 for 133.
John Embry comes in at number 7 with England 5 wickets down. They've gone for Bruce French again as their wicketkeeper, which means that their batting is not quite as long as it used to be in the early matches. And with the fifth wicket gone there, Bill Athey coming inside of his stumps, too far across. And there's all sorts of confusion there. And Embry was a long, long way out. And instead of being run out, they get two. Well, there was all sorts of panic and confusion. And in the end, Richards, with a clear throw at the stumps, missed them. 5 for 138. We have a change in bowling. Walsh is back on at this end.
And that's out. Kind of anything more simple than that. Joel Garner, the catcher. John Embry, the would-be assassin who has just gently put the ball into Garner's hands.
Well, that was just like you see them do when they're practicing catching. There's one man who stands there, someone else tosses the ball to him, and he deliberately angles the bat and steers it to the close catchers. That's exactly what Embry did. 6 for 143.
Philip De Freitas is the new batsman. England deep in trouble here, 6 for 143. Almost in deeper trouble.
Courtney Walsh has bowled very well for the West Indies today. Had a very good first spell. Well, there was nothing too devilish about that delivery which got Embry. Just moved away and helped it on its way straight into the hands of Joel Garner.
Walsh. It's gone, yes. For the third time, trying to hit the ball square of the wickets. Got a faint touch. Dewdine did the rest. The end of Chris Broad. A fine, almost a lone fighting hand for England. He's out for 76. The West Indies picking up valuable wickets in the 46th over.
Bit of bounce there again, try to run that one down to third man, and Chris Broad, having played superbly for England, is now out for 76. Dujon made the catch, and 7 for 158.
Now Neil Foster to try and lift the score for England. They're in a lot of trouble here. Their last chance today if they miss out. Good piece of bowling by Courtney Walsh, enticed Broad to play that little dab and got a faint edge. Malcolm Marshall continues. He's been very, very fast. And this wicket, with a little bit of movement and bounce, it's very difficult to score. Batsmen having trouble putting bat onto ball when they first come to the crease. Well, this could be a runner if he hits. Richards with a big chance this time. He's got the three. He gets him. He's got one at last. The great Viv Richards gets three to throw at. Hits the middle stump and Foster run out. And at last, Richards finds the stumps.
Yes, good bit of fielding by Richards. He took his time and kept his eye on the ball. Ran across, picked it up. And then all he had to do really was to hit the stumps. And this is how it happened. Ball played away on the onside. Batting batsman there coming down. Have a look at that throw. Whack, in she goes. The bales fly. And that was a pretty good bit of fielding by Vivian Richards. So Neil Foster out, run out. And the score now 8 for 159.
Four overs to be bowled. French comes out to join Philip De Freitas. And it's Malcolm Marshall's flat out.
But once Lamb got out, I think that's where it started going wrong. This is the run out again. The batsman very late in setting off then, eventually out by 2 yards. Neil Foster, had he perhaps set off straight away, may well have got himself in. Have a look how he stops there. And the other batsman's halfway through before he even sets off. So all it really needed was stumps to be broken, and Viv Richards came to the party.
Got him, cream bowl, too fast for French. Great bit of bowling by Marshall. He's a great bowler. He's quick, he's straight, and he's hostile. Cleaning up the tail.
Put yourself in the position. Bruce French has hardly had a bat in his hand all summer. Has to face Malcolm Marshall. And this is what happened. It just went through him before he really had picked it up, either in terms of its line or length. So another breakthrough for the West Indies. A disappointed Bruce French, who had such a great night with the gloves the other night. He's also moving off this ground, accompanied by Daddles. 9 for 160.
Gladstone Small joins Philip De Freitas. 48th over, about to start. England have lost 4 wickets for 17. Tail has not wagged as Malcolm Marshall crashes through the defence of Bruce French. Takes middle and off stump. He was a fraction late. But Marshall's bowled superbly here at Devonport today. England 9 for 168. Courtney Walsh to bowl the final over. It's well struck. That'll beat mid off. His run's so important on a wicket that's giving the bowlers a little bit of assistance. He's coming back for the third. Good running.
Bill, I don't think this game's over yet. It's a low score. England have struggled against this West Indian attack. But the West Indians have had their problems too with the bat this summer. Not a bad shot, played through the gap on the offside.
It's a nice thick edge, races down to Payne at third man. It's the single, wide throw, there's a chance if he hits Dujon, he misses. So the crowd roars, 10,000 people here at Devonport getting the thrill of one day cricket.
Yes, just getting back to England's plight here. 173 the score now. One flicked away down towards fine leg. They take one. Fieldsman, I think, perhaps reckoning that they won't go back for the second. Eventually they did. Dujon was onto it quickly, but he's not been very accurate with his slow throws at the stumps over the season. He's missed on numerous occasions.
Final delivery, full pitch, down the ground, they'll come back for the second. Richie Richardson's coming in, we hit the stumps, the underarm's in, it's wide. He's home. So two off the final delivery. So after 50 overs, England, after being sent in by Vivian Richards, are 9 for 177. Chris Broad, 76, Alan Lamb, 36, and De Freitas not out, 15, the main scorers. 9 for 177.
Well, England did fractionally better there than might have been supposed at the halfway mark, where we thought they might have got to 170, anything above that being a bonus, but they didn't get very much above it. A measure of the West Indies skill and tight bowling power out there, and also their excellent fielding on this small ground. A look at the card shows that there were just three men there in double figures. Broad made 76 and played extremely well. I should think he's pushed his chances for that International Cricketer of the Year award. Lamb 36 and De Freitas 15, the only others in double figures right down the bottom there under the name of extras. Bowling figures, some splendid work there from Marshall, 3 for 31, bowled really well again today. Gray coming in for Holding did a fine job for Richards, 2 for 29 in 10 overs. 2 for 31 to Walsh, who bowled very well, particularly early in his spell, and I thought Harper today gave one of his better exhibitions of off-spin bowling. So West Indies need 178 to win. The asking rate is not very high. The only thing you can say for England is that they have the runs on the board and they will be desperate out there because this is their last chance. Richie Richardson's in strike. De Freitas is the bowler. And off the mark for Richie Richardson, and he'll pick up two runs. Good running between the wickets on a day that is in complete contrast to the 35 degrees they're having in Sydney at the moment.
And that's gone, caught behind, so Richardson goes once more to De Freitas, outside edge. England have got an early wicket, and Richie Richardson, who has had two ducks in his two previous innings, goes for two.
That was the classic outswinger. Batsman committed to follow. Regulation edge. French takes the catch. So first blood to the Englishman now, Richie Richardson, out for three, a long stay of 19 deliveries. And the score at the moment is 1 for 10.
So here's the adjustment in the batting order, which was predictable, with the right-hander going first. Instead of sending Larry Gomes in at number three, in comes Gus Logie. Right-hander replacing right-hander as there's a left-hander at the other end.
That's well played. That's beat the fieldsman down there as well, right off the meat of the bat. He's tried to play that shot on numerous occasions and played and missed. But he got a bit of bat on that one.
in the air, but safe enough, three parts of the way, well, almost 7/8 of the way to the boundary. Nothing pretty about Thelson's stroke play, but he's very effective. Here now is Gladstone Small, he's the new bowler.
Once again, that one cut away square on the offside. He's beginning to really middle them now, is Thelston Payne. That is a good shot.
It's not the place to bowl to Thelston Payne. He's a very strong square cutter. You've really got to have the ball up, make him play forward as much as possible. Now Botham comes on.
Oh, big appeal. He's got him straight away. Botham has strangled the wicket with a ball that was very short outside off stump. There are those that say, have said over the years that he's a strangler. Well, that one was short. It was wide. Thelston Payne went for the cut, which he's been playing so well, and he got a thick edge through to French.
Well, you wouldn't believe that, would you? It only just carried through to French. Pitched halfway down. And that's not the two fingers, that's the five fingers. Thelston Payne out for 18, 2 for 25.
Larry Gomes, the new batsman. He's only played in 3 matches in this competition. Well, both of them has just taken his second wicket in this tournament. That was a very wide and very short delivery. And Thelston Payne, the victim. That's a very good shot. A short delivery. Botham does this quite often in his first over. And that one smashed away to the boundary with ease. So 4 more to the total, and the West Indies now 2 for 30.
It's a comparison after 18 overs, so there's nothing in this match. The England tail didn't wag, but there's still some movement up the seam from this pitch. The run rate required now 4.22.
Both them to Gomes. Gomes steers that one fine, and Gladstone Small can't cut it off.
Well, that's the type of edge that can win a match like this when it's very tight. It was an edge. French didn't dive. It was probably wide of the keeper, but it was certainly a genuine nick. And it raced away for 4. The unflappable Larry Gomes picking up 4 valuable runs. A thick outside edge.
John Embury coming into bowl.
Nicely placed there by Gus Logie, heading downwind. No problem in reaching the boundary. All you need to do is find the gap.
Yes, Embury just a fraction short. Logie back quickly and slashed that through the cover region. The boundary is now starting to come for the West Indian side. Well placed. Split point and cover. Brings up the 50 for the West Indian side.
Just wide of Gladstone Small and away to the boundary. Bit fortunate with that shot.
It's just beaten a fraction in flight by John Embry, but he went on with it. He didn't check his shot at all. He followed through and hit it with a fair amount of power. Just eluded mid-off and short cover and raced away for 4.
Both in the bowler. Got him. At leg slip, played straight to the man there, and that's very well done by Botham and the captain Gatting. They put him in that position. He bowled it just short of a length, and Larry Gomes fell straight into the gap.
Doesn't often happen that you see the fieldsman placed there and directly the catch is hit straight to him, and Botham would feel a little proud about having brought off that move. Gomes been at the crease for quite a while. He made 20. West Indies 3 for 71 in the 27th.
So a big cheer for Viv Richards, the West Indian captain, as he strides out to the centre now. Botham has taken 2 wickets for 20, including this one.
It's the plot was there, the trap set, and straight to him. Regulation couldn't have happened better. Johnny Embry takes the catch, the England vice-captain. He's taken some fantastic catches this summer.
Botham. Bowling! That's a big wicket for Botham. Viv Richards trying to cut that one away down towards third man. The ball nipped back a little bit. And Viv Richards out comprehensively bowled by the England all-rounder.
A sense of occasion. Thanks for coming further down under, Botham. The world's great all-rounder. His mate, Richards, goes the off-cutter, a little slower ball. Only 1 wicket coming into this game, but certainly he's risen. England must win this game. West Indies captain 1. And the West Indies 4 wickets down now for 73 in the 29th over.
Ian Botham, man who is doing the damage here for England, and we now have a game. Richards back in the pavilion, Dujon in. Next man in is Harper. And I shall be very surprised now if England can't put that little bit of extra pressure on the West Indies, and this could be a pretty close game. Botham. Well, it's in the air, down towards square leg, and that'll go for 4. Well, that wasn't a good ball. It's amazing. He bowls a good one, and then every now and again he slips in one of those long hops.
He's been like that all his life, Botham. Never been one to step back and not experiment. That's how Viv Richards went. That was the off-cutter, a little slower. Viv, cross-bat shot, trying to glide it down through the vacant slip area. We've got a match on our hands here. We really have. The West Indies 4 for 80. Languishing behind now. 2 wickets worse off. England were 12 runs better off. Remember, the target is 178 runs.
Well played. Once again, the short ball bowled by Botham, dispatched with confident ease across to the boundary there at square leg.
Well, they're enjoying that, the locals here. Nearly 10,000 have turned up to see this inaugural Benson Hedges World Series Cup game here. Aspirations for test matches on this ground by the Tasmanians. Surface is good, crowd good. And we've got a game on our hands here now.
It's in the air, going down towards the boundary at square leg. There's no one there, and it'll probably bob over the boundary. Yes, it will. Into the boundary. 3 for 33, Botham's figures. And the total now, 4 for 89.
Neil Foster comes back into the attack.
What a wicket. First ball for Neil Foster back into the attack. And little Gus Luggie is on his way back to the pavilion. Boy, that'll make those English fans in the udder very happy. This is going to be a close game.
Well, the desperation needed by the England camp. I'm surprised a bit with Foster taken off after 4 overs in his first spell, but been saved. And what a comeback. Luggie goes down, clean bowled. The off-cutter works. Augustine Logie out for 31. West Indies 5 for 90 and a fight on their hands.
Roger Harper is out there. He joins Geoffrey Dujon. Dujon has 13. 12 of which have been made in boundaries. But have a look at this for a little nip-backer, which sneaks through to the fences of Logie.
Can't beat line and length. Logie again hitting across the line. We saw him wrapped on the pads just a few deliveries before that. Botham was bowling to him, also Embry, and paying the penalty there. Can't hit across the line. The delivery is on line, doing a little bit. Much better to try and hit the ball straighter between that V, mid-off and mid-on.
Here's Gladstone Small coming back into the attack now. He had 5 overs at the beginning, bowled pretty well, just 12 runs taken from him. He's gone. West Indies have lost another wicket. And England now well and truly on top. West Indies 6 for 95, Harper out for 4.
This has been an amazing comeback by England. West Indies seem to be strolling along at 2 down. Suddenly a collapse. The 6th man to go, Roger Harper, easily caught by Bruce French. And the West Indies are now 6 for 95.
So here comes Malcolm Marshall to join Geoffrey Dujon. No doubt Dujon coming up to him and telling him that it still can be done. Malcolm Marshall, who has worked his heart out as a bowler so far, batsmen haven't supported him.
Roger Harper out when Gladstone Small was brought back into the attack. He attempted to glide one down to third man, only succeeded in finding Bruce French's gloves. That's the 3rd catch for French in this innings.
In the advantageous position. And that's a huge hit. Back comes Embry, and he just won't get there. So Malcolm Marshall seems now to have decided that he has to take the long handle to the bowlers.
We've got plenty of loft on it, and he's hitting virtually downwind, but it still didn't quite carry over the boundary rope. Landed just a few or a meter or perhaps 2 meters at the most short of the boundary rope.
It's safe over to Freitas's head. Now this is an all-out assault by the West Indians to get themselves back in this game.
There's the ball, well and truly crashed over the boundary line. Green stitching, a white ball, and that one bruised as its flat bat swatted down the ground. One bounce, two bounce, and into the Benson and Hedges sign. Nick De Freitas being brought back into the attack.
Athey, he's caught a lot this year and he's caught another one. Well, West Indies were going along perfectly well there. Now they will have to struggle once again. De Freitas has struck, being brought back on by Gatting. Every bowling change Gatting has made has been successful.
He's tried to take the gas. Really did. Malcolm Marshall could have worked the ball around in ones and twos and achieved success comfortably, but he went for the big hit, and I couldn't think of a safer man to be under that catch than Bill Athey. Crowd really coming to their feet now. They see a tense struggle ahead for the West Indies. Marshall out for 27. The score 7 for 132 as the trumpets come out. As Marshall had been there for just 26 deliveries. He scored 27 runs. And then added 37. It was a fine partnership. Really beginning to look very dangerous from the England point of view. And England must win this match. There's no second chance for them on Friday night.
7 for 147. We're now coming up into the 48th over. 3 overs to go. 31 runs needed. So it's desperation time for the West Indies. They still have another chance against Australia. But for England, victory today will give them 8 points, level with Australia, but not with the same high run rate. Problems for Mike Gatting. John Embery is coming back on again in the commentary box. Ian Chappell, and alongside him is Bill Lurie.
Three overs to be bowled, two possibly by John Embry. He's bowled eight overs, no wicket for 25. He's bowling into the breeze, so the batsman will be hitting down the ground towards cover with a strong assisting westerly. So Embry comes into Dujon. Full pitch, and he's out! Straight to Mike Gatting at square leg. A full toss. He ripped it to Gatting. Gatting took the catch, and that could be it with 10 runs and over required as a captain picks up a vital catch.
The full toss has struck a few times in the World Series Cup competition, but probably never on a more important occasion than this. The England skipper gets a nice easy catch, and isn't he delighted about that? The eighth wicket is down with the total at 147.
Tony Gray joins Joel Garner. Garner on four. Gray yet to face a delivery from John Embry, the last man out. Vice captain Dujon caught at square leg for 34. Top scored so far, three boundaries of 57 balls faced. Jeffrey Dujon. Embry to Gray. Full pitch. It's gone. Well, can you believe it? Another full pitch. He's hit it straight back on the wicket. Out went the right core. He dragged it in. He's on a hat trick, and England look like going into the finals with one match to play.
It could well be a hat-trick of full tosses. The curving full toss, Tony Gray gets it on the leading edge, and what's even worse for the West Indies, the batsmen haven't crossed again. So poor old Joel Garner remains at the non-striker's end. Tony Gray is out for a duck, and the West Indies 9 for 147.
So John Embry on a hat-trick, West Indies 9 for 147. Courtney Walsh beaten, beautifully taken. Fine piece of work by the wicketkeeper. No result by French.
Well, somehow or other, the West Indies have got to get Joel Garner up on strike. There are three balls left in this over. Courtney Walsh has got to get a single, at least give him a couple hitting downwind.
He's gone for it. He's missed it again. French takes it. Well, the West Indies play Australia on Friday at the Sydney Cricket Ground. The run rate, the problem for the West Indies. Beaten again by the arm ball. Just a single. So at last, Joel Garner gets some strike. Two wickets by John Embry in his second last over. Really turned the tide here. 13 balls remaining. One wicket in hand and 30 runs required.
Bowling!
Embry gets three in his final over. So now England in with a big chance to go into the final. I guess it all will depend on Friday's match if the West Indies can almost double their run rate. But a surprise victory here at Devonport. All out for 148 as thousands of England supporters stream onto the ground.
Oh, would you believe it? Another small total and England successfully able to defend it. That was a very fine exhibition of out cricket and bowling from Mike Gatting's side. They kept on putting the pressure on. West Indies fought back on a number of occasions, but they now have real problems. The card of the West Indies innings shows it all. At the end of the day, all out for 148 in 48 overs and a top score of 34 from Jeffrey Dujon. There's a 31 and a 27 in there, a 20 and an 18, but the consistency isn't there and it was a cruel blow for them when they lost Vivian Richards, bowled by Botham. Botham's bowling today after one or two loose ones early on while he was getting that side stretched and loosened up. It was very good. 3 for 33 he took. The other bowling figures, 2 for 20 for De Freitas and Small, 1 for 36. Foster, I thought, bowled excellently again. 1 for 30 from 10 overs. He bowled well in Melbourne the other day. And then Embury, 9 overs, no maiden, 3 for 26. And also, he was on a hat-trick. Now, the man of the match, Chris Broad, and deservedly so. It was a very fine innings on a pitch where the ball was always doing something. It was moving off the seam, a little bit of extra bounce here and there. A very fine effort from him. 76 in that small total put up by England. And the points table, it stands at the moment Australia 8 and England 8. The odds are that those two teams will go through because they have the two best run rates. West Indies have to beat Australia at the Sydney Cricket Ground in the final preliminary match of the Benson Hedges World Series Cup. And we reckon they have to score at over 7 runs per over if they bat first. That will give them a total of something around about 370. Well, it has been done before in limited overs cricket. The records are there. So the West Indies, if they need the motivation, can look at those statistics, but it is going to be a fairly arduous task for them. I fear they have only themselves to blame. Some of their cricket's been a little bit loose. Other times it's been absolutely brilliant. Today, for example, their fielding was quite magnificent and they fought very, very hard. You would have thought that that total, 177, was within their reach. They weren't quite able to do it because the batsmen once again faltered when the pressure was on. So down here at Devonport, it's been a windy, blustery day. West Indies' chances have been blown out to Bass Strait, and we look forward now to the West Indies meeting Australia in the next match at the Sydney Cricket Ground. That is a day-night match, and we look forward to having you with us for that game, which should provide plenty of fireworks. For the moment, it's good night.
This has been another presentation from Nine's Wide World of Sports.